seat, is that the protocol? Oh, button on, okay.
It's not for?
It's just for the recording?
Yes.
Okay.
And so can you just kind of walk through what you're planning?
Sure, we are planning, oh, I'm Tara Nelson, I'm from Tiger Lily's Events, and we'll be doing the event at the Long Hill Orchard, which is Cindy Adams' farm. So we're planning two farm-to-table dinners, and then the third day that's on the request is actually a private wedding. So we would need a liquor license for all three, obviously, since it's an event.
So these three are, like, you said there's two dinners, so they're separate, like, they're distinctly three different events?
Yes, they are.
Rehearsal dinners for the wedding?
Nope, they're three separate events, yes. So the first two farm-to-table dinners are a ticketed event, people buy tickets, and then we have two local chefs that get sort of the mystery basket, sort of a la Chopped, if you watch Food Network. Everything is grown within a 15-mile radius of the farm, so we use all local cheesemakers, local bakers, local beer, wine, that kind of thing. So everything is from a very small radius. And then we're going to use the flying field at the farm, which is absolutely beautiful. So.
Do you have an approximate number of people that you think might be attending each of the three? Well, the wedding you would know.
Right. So we try to keep it at 80 people. Sometimes we are a little oversold, but we really can't fit much more than 90 people in the tent. So, and then with staff, it's about 100 people total. So we will have three bartenders that are tip certified. Our insurance covers, I believe, 120 people, just to, in case we go over by anything. And then we have two porta potties. Those are sort of the infrastructure bits.
How about the wedding?
How about the wedding?
How many people?
Oh, I'm sorry, 90 people at the wedding. Yeah, it all works out to be the very same numbers. So. Cindy will plant one special.
I'm sorry.
I said Cindy will plant one special for him.
So every wedding that's on a private, somebody has, I have a wedding at my house with 75 people and serving alcohol. That would require a police detail? So that's basically what they're happening, right?
But there's two other ones. I think there's a distinction with what you said. This is a paid event.
There's just two other nights, so then that would be, well, for ask for detail on the two paid events.
Not on the wedding.
I'm
just asking. I don't know. I'm one of those persons, if we do one for one, we have to start doing it for everybody.
Right.
So if somebody has a wedding at the house, we could even be a part of doing that for details. So,
right. There was a wedding on, it was a former chief, but there was a wedding on Cherry Hill Street, similar.
Same 500 would be traffic.
Right.
That the chief has said no to detail, even though there's alcohol detail, but yes to a fireman on duty, whatever they do, because of the law about having inside of the building with no sprinkler heads. If you serve an alcohol, you need to have a fire watch. So I would leave that discretion on the chief.
I just wondered, have you done some of these events before?
Yes, I have. I'm an event planner, so I've done plenty of weddings and parties, and in the past 3 years, I've really focused strongly on local farm-to-table dinner, so I've done them at many different farms, in a couple in Maine, and then Newberry, and actually both farms that I've worked with in the past have been in Newberry, so.
I think I read, so it's intended to get over around 9 or 9:30 or
yes.
Something like that?
Mm-hmm. 9:30 is the stop time, which means the bar would close at 9. These are tasting, so there are 3-ounce pours with each course that goes out, so it's not like an open bar. I'm particularly stringent with, you know, the tip certification and making sure everyone is, we use a wristband system, so they have to come in and check ID. We give them a wristband. We don't sell tickets to anyone under 21, but we also do check IDs anyway to make sure that nobody sort of slipped through the cracks, and 3-ounce pours, and that's it. So.
So there is no walk-up bar.
No, there's no walk-up bar.
Oh.
No.
So hypothetically, you have if the first course was some type of chicken and fish, you would have some accompaniment, some white wine, and mm-hmm. 3 ounces that you'd be sipping with your first course, and then hypothetically, you had some beef, you had 3 ounces of red wine, and
right.
Then maybe you'd have a quart of something for dessert.
You can run my job then.
And then 2 hours, you probably have water for people to try.
Yes,
to
yep.
So mm-hmm. hypothetically, you wouldn't even do the whole night. If an 8-ounce drink, you'd be basically giving somebody one drink.
I think it works out to about 2.5,
well,
because it's
you're
5 courses.
You know,
right.
Like 6 ounces. But you're pretty good, you'd give like 8 ounces.
Yes.
Yeah,
so. No.
Yes, Chris.
I spoke with Paul Savigny for the Board of Health on Friday, and he said that they will need a permit for the food. And they also said, Paul also said that they should clean up the potties, whatever
porta-potties.
They are, in between the 7th
mm-hmm.
and 8th.
Yes.
So that the 10th, it's
clean
I do every single day,
okay.
So both of them.
Well, we're only approving the liquor license, right?
Right.
Yeah.
That's my understanding, but.
Yes, and
mm-hmm.
the kind of event. But we just got to give you a heads up that.
That's something you have to work
mm-hmm. on. Right.
So you work
mm-hmm.
entirely. You've been
yes.
doing this for 3 years, or you've been an event planner for them for 3 years? You know what I mean? So you've worked
with. No. I've worked with different farms for the past 3 years doing farm-to-table dinners.
Are you Tiger Lily?
I am Tiger Lily's. I've been doing
You're
events.
You're
no, that's a caterer. I'm an event planner. I'm different from the Tiger Lily kid. I had my name first, I'll just say, too. They stole the name from me. But no, we're fine. I refer business to them. Well, I've been doing it for 25 years, so.
So, let me ask you questions. So, if you have shots, and this is more Board of Health question,
mm-hmm.
somebody's going to have a serve safe certificate.
Yes.
To file with the Board of Health, and probably have a plan in the kitchen how they're going to sanitize their hands, and if something drops on the floor, they have to have be able to have sanitizer. You have to have a mobile kitchen set up and all that kind of stuff.
Exactly.
That's something you're going to have to do with the Board of Health.
Right.
And he's good. He'll work with you.
Yes.
So. All the locally vegetables and whatever, it really doesn't matter what it is. It's not cooked on site, it's cooked off in the commissary, it's the kitchen,
it's,
and then brought there?
Most of it is brought there, and then they warm it on site. So they have there are two mobile kitchens set up.
What do they consist of?
There's a propane stove, there's a grill, there's a like a hot pot so they can have boiling water at all times. tables, you know, tent over the kitchen because you can't have open food. So we have not picked the two chefs yet, so.
Where do they come from?
Local chefs. So I've had chefs that are from Crave, from Saya, from Barking Dog in Amesbury, then Number 8 in Amesbury. So it's all local chefs that come in with their kitchen staff. So they get the basket delivered to them the day before the event. And then they prepare everything. I know it is a little easier, but they don't know what they're getting. So
octopus, Twinkies.
Hard to get local Twinkies, but we can try.
Okay, I'm done. You good?
I'm
good. No, I want
to
go.
I move to approve a one-day liquor license for Karen Nelson and / Cindy Adams for September 7th, 8th, and 10th.
Yes. Thank you very much. Pardon me?
The tickets are $85 per person, $150 per couple, and then there's a reduced rate for a party of 10.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And this is benefiting the farm too?
Yes.
And, well, you know, I guess he has the choice, the discretion. We have adopted the non-criminal disposition where you basically write a ticket. Same thing, you know, the police have authority for that, and we could designate other individuals to have that authority.
The police have authority
to issue a citation for any violation of the town bylaws. Anyone. So technically, if someone has a loose dog, you could write a ticket for it. If someone has their livestock go on the public way in violation of our thing, they could write a ticket for it. If someone puts snow in the street in violation of our bylaw, they could write a ticket for it. Now, in accordance with our bylaws, there are a number of other officials who also share that authority. For example, we have a bylaw requiring the numbering of residential houses, and the building inspector has authority to issue that. We have a bylaw with regard to watering, and the water commissioner and superintendent of the waterworks has the power to give out tickets for that. So. Well, you know, I don't know if we have a dust bylaw. They have independent authority under the under the Board of Health regulations. Yeah, but that was under the Board of Health regulations themselves. So we have different jurisdictions. We have one is our own bylaws and the criminal disposition and the non-criminal the tickets we could write. In addition to that, they have the authority under the lodging regulations themselves, which, you know, you could bring an action against someone for a fine of $100 to $500 plus imprisonment of 3 months, in addition to the right to, you know, revocate, revoke, or suspend the licenses in accordance with it. So that is currently, as it is written in our enforcement. I mean, it's a little shorthand, but we have all those powers currently in our draft.
I think our main concern is, as of right now, we have limited the number of lodgers to 8 people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think that was our primary enforcement concern, how we would actually do that. How we would enforce that. And I think there was a lady in the audience last time who had a very good idea of, you can look at how many cars are sitting there at 6 o'clock in the morning, and that's a pretty good indication if there's 10 cars, there was more than 8 people standing there overnight, X the, you know, the full-time residents.
What other...
I don't know if you have any thoughts.
I have a lot of thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know that's shocking. obviously, I understand the dilemma, obviously, for the neighborhood, because it would be no different than if I was in the neighborhood living. It's a quality of life issue. I think the horse kind of got out of the gate long ago, and now it's finally being corralled back up, and people want some, I guess, some sanity within their own neighborhood, and I totally agree with that. But also the rights of, obviously, the homeowner that's trying to run the Airbnb. So I guess, like most times, the police chief is always caught in the middle, but I'm used to that after 31 years. What other department within the town is actually regulating this beyond what powers have been bestowed upon my department?
I think we're trying to figure that out.
Okay. I have no problem, and I have a desire to obviously help the town, obviously. We've been working diligently with the residents of that street, because I would not want those issues on my street. We all come home after a hard day of work, and we want quiet time. I understand that more than anybody else. To date, I think we've maybe fielded 3 or 4 calls for service. I think most of those I've done personally myself, because I wanted to try to be involved and have a firsthand knowledge of the different reports that we received.
3 or 4 calls for service in total?
Since I've been here, that I've personally taken care of myself. Where I was going with this, what I've done is we've investigated it, whether it's a speeding complaint or a general complaint or concern. They've all been documented, and they've been forwarded, obviously, to the town. That way all parties, town as well as any other side, are familiar with what the standing issues are. I plan on continuing to do that. Obviously, if there's any criminal action, absolutely the police department's going to get involved. Or if it's a speeding issue or a disorderly conduct issue, we're obviously going to be involved as well. If there's an occupancy issue, say on a Friday night, I don't see the police department going down there and tossing people out.
No.
What I foresee is if we get a call, which again, it's going to be problematic because obviously people can visit people there at that house. So it becomes problematic of which cars belong to whom, why they're there, and how long they're there.
It's more the cars that are there at 6 a.m.
I certainly understand that. Sure.
If this was during normal working hours, who are the options that the enforcement of the number of people, where would that be?
Well, whoever you would designate, you are the licensing authority, so you have, the selectmen have independent power, so you could theoretically designate, you know, anyone. Usually in our town, it's the building inspectors, it's an enforcement officer. There isn't really.
There really isn't anybody.
Some people would use a health agent. That would be, a person.
Occupancy. Who the best?
Right. Yeah. Really, would be the police, because one of the things that the way you would do it is that under the proposed bylaw. And they're required to, every guest is required to enter into the register. and the information includes their vehicle and their vehicle number. If the police came and took down the numbers of the vehicles there, and then they would be able to demand the register
at any
time. And if they found a discrepancy, then that would be prima facie evidence to issue a citation. And if the person disputed it, then they would be able to dispute it. And that's essentially how you would have to enforce it. I don't think you'd be able to enforce it in a circumstance of, you know, kicking people out, let's say. Yeah. But it's just that, like speeding laws, is that the, you know, if you issue enough citations, then people will comply.
Or you could revoke the license.
That would be evidence to, yeah. You, and then you as a licensing authority would have that that opportunity.
So, I'm just kind of thinking that loud here. I mean, that would, the optimal time to look at, there's too many people there, would be, you know, as daylight, like 5 a.m., 6 a.m. But that's not the time you're going to go in and check the register.
No.
Anybody's going to go in and check our register.
No.
That's why I asked, like, who would be.
No. You'd just be able to compare one to the other, and that, you know, and if you didn't have it.
Even 3 weeks later.
Theoretically, yeah. I mean,
timely would probably be best, though.
Right.
I mean,
right,
yeah.
I mean, that day would be the later that day would be the optimal.
It's the midnight shift with one police officer on down there for half an hour.
It's not. I'll tell you what. That is not what the police department is going to be utilized for.
I'm
I know you are.
We have
and
two
I,
or three that even town.
Yeah. That.
Or a house that has two or three that have out of state plates or
yeah.
The salesmen.
I understand the dilemma and I fully support it. Dumping it on my lap is not the end all, save all. We all have to work together, whether it's the Board of Health, us obviously following up, going, getting license plates, talking to people, and forwarding it to the Board of Health or something like that. Yes, absolutely. But
or forwarding it to our department.
Yeah. Or
and then,
the other ones
to. Sending out, and us sending out a letter saying that we would like to see the guest register on June 7th of 2016.
Send it up the next day. I, again, to reiterate, I understand the residents' issue about strangers in the neighborhood, speeding cars, people running through the yard. I would feel the exact same way that they do now.
Well, we can take care of speeding
yeah.
cars.
Yes, I.
We can take care of some. Property.
Absolutely.
They can walk down the street.
Absolutely.
Public way. We can take care of those types of things.
That can be immediate results so long as we get an immediate call that we can send, obviously, someone down there, providing that they're, like you said, they're not involved in something else. But absolutely, because I would want the same in my own neighborhood. But still, to work together with the town, you know, compiling the same reports that we've done up to date, and that way everybody is on the same page, so to speak. But for the residents on that town, we needed a call when it happens, you know, not after the fact, because obviously it makes it harder for us to obviously resolve an issue, you know, if it's 2, 3, or 4 hours after the fact.
I've had that, you see, because of the tension down there, you're getting like 7 phone calls on the weekend, or 10 phone calls, your car would be down there.
I encourage the phone calls, but leaving a message on my phone, on my desk, 10 o'clock on a Friday night, is not going to do anybody any good. Well, that's where the call should go.
Yeah, of course.
Absolutely. I encourage people to call if there's a problem. We'll go down and obviously address those issues immediately, but people have to call the dispatch center, not my desk. And thank you.
Yeah. At 6 o'clock, there's 7 cars there. All of a sudden, okay, another one showed up. At 8 o'clock, we send the car down here. 9 o'clock, that one left, but 2 more showed up.
Yeah.
I think that's a futile exercise, looking at the number of cars there at night. I mean, there could be visitors. I mean, it's who's there in the morning.
Yeah, I agree. I'm just trying to think it out loud.
Yep.
This is going to be a hard fix.
Yep. The The police department will do everything it can to help mitigate all the issues down there the best we can.
Like if you did a swing through at whatever, like I'm just using 6 a.m. or whatever, to kind of see if, you know, you can see if there's 8, 10, 12 cars there, and if there's not, just leave. If there is, then.
Well, I think the east, yeah, it's yeah, easy to take a swing through like we swing through any other neighborhood. Now, obviously, there's an issue on that street, and whoever the officer is to swing by, okay. Not knowing what the homeowner's vehicles are. Take a picture or jot down the license plate of whatever vehicles were there and add
it. Report it back to us.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously, it, wherever it goes, we could certainly get the names of those people that are registered to those vehicles. But yeah, whoever the officer is at 5 o'clock. At 5 o'clock. Everywhere nowadays, but yeah, you're right. And that becomes problematic in itself.
With excise tax, they're not supposed to, not supposed to house a vehicle that has outside out-of-state license plates at your home, even if it's a work car or something without being local license.
Yeah, that happens in New Hampshire a lot because it's a lot cheaper to register a car. Probably even the easier thing to do before we just start giving out license plates and people who own whatever the car it is probably to compare that maybe the owner of whatever a Airbnb provide the town every Monday with a list of whoever their residents were and their vehicles, which they have to supply anyways. Those could be compared to what we have, and then we can send a report. I just don't want to start blanketing, sending information. It becomes a lot more labor intensive.
Right.
So every Monday, if they have guests Thursday through Sunday, or whatever it is,
the previous week
they provide, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Jones, they were driving Mass, New Hampshire, Idaho, or whatever it is.
The regulations,
yes.
Basically reporting requirements.
Email over, you could even email over to us to keep the police out of it.
Well, that would be better. And then
if we got questions, and then it would be the enforcement, and they would check on complaints and so forth.
Yeah, that way you don't even have to be the enforcing.
No, we're obviously would make a standard practice a Friday or Saturday, one or the other or both, depending on what's going on, to drive by about 6 o'clock, 5 o'clock, jot all the plates down, put it in our log, and call it a day, and then if the problem arises, then we can obviously mix match of the date, the time.
Yeah, when we say you had too many, and they say, no, we didn't,
yeah.
The neighbor complained, we'll say, I'm sorry, you had nine cars.
There was an officer there.
Yeah, you had nine cars.
He's recommending a bylaw be added, which would
Well, I mean, I did a survey of about a dozen different cities and towns which have regulations, and there are different approaches. One town used the Board of Health, actually, under their Board of Health powers to issue regulations. Another town just issued it pursuant to your licensing authority, which you presently have, and a third town, you know, put in a bylaw, you know, to support their own, you know, licensing authority regulations. So, and I know that was approved by the Attorney General. So, that would hold muster. So, we could have something ready for that. And I would add, and I would change some of our suggestions here about the board can require, you know, weekly reporting. Beef up the register requirements so that it's a matter of function, you know, which might be important too if the legislature ever passes a local tax on this, which is going to happen.
The Airbnb tax.
Yeah, that's good. That, I mean, that will.
It's gonna happen.
What?
It seems like it's going.
It's going to happen. I mean, not because of West Newbury, but because because of Boston and Cambridge and. Everyone else are foregoing a rather substantial amount of money now.
And they want an even playing field.
Yeah, exactly.
Cambridge and stuff because you have hotel taxes.
Exactly.
So do you might move forward with the different things in here? Part of them are to go into the regulations. Part of them would be an article for a bylaw.
Right. I can have that by the next meeting.
Excellent. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thanks for having me. I have, whenever the board has a moment, I have a number of different other items that I just want to bring up to the board's attention, more about where we are and where we're going.
Is it like a minute or something we should schedule for us next meeting? Or
if nobody asks me a thing, and I can rattle it off, it should be in probably no more than 2 minutes. I want to thank the board for coming out for National Night Out. I appreciate the three of you there and supporting it. I think it was quite successful this year. If we measure it on how many hot dogs we gave 300 away compared to 200. So I guess one third more the people, I guess. It was largely due to my secretary, Sue, and obviously the Council on Aging Director, Teresa, who did a lot of the background work to made it as successful as it did. So obviously kudos to them. There were a lot of people, and I can't thank them all tonight, but obviously the board, Sue and Teresa, definitely Fire Chief Mike Dwyer and Deputy Chief Dave Evans and the fire company and the fire department for all their help that day and afterwards, and all the company of the fire department. It was a breath of fresh air to have all of us working together, striving for the same thing. So I certainly appreciate that, as well as Mass State Police. If you were there, you saw that the helicopter finally came in, which was probably the best thing of the whole night. I like to think our cruisers are nice, but let's face it, the helicopter was a lot better. You had to stay to the end. That was the grand finale fireworks, was the helicopter. Also, kudos out to Merrimack, Angrove, and Fire and Police. As I had told the board prior, that I'm trying to make it more of a tri-town and trying to get us working together. So I think overall, it was a very successful event. August 10th, which is in 2 days, we're having another movie night, which is sponsored by the town's cable TV company, the Council on Aging, and obviously the police department. Glenn has been very helpful with obviously supplying popcorn to the National Night Out, which was another big hit. And also, I'm hoping not to put you on the spot.
Wednesday the 10th,
8 o'clock-ish, rain or shine. If it does rain, we're going to have it inside the annex. And the second date will be the 23rd. Please don't ask me the name of the movie because I have no idea yet.
Zootopia is the first one.
Yeah, the second one we don't know yet. Department of Agriculture, It's the first time I've ever heard of this. They're going to be doing flybys to some of the farms, spreading grass seed. Their date of inception is anywhere from today, which it did not happen, to the end of the month. They're going to call me, hopefully, the day prior to them coming and doing flyovers over the town, spreading the grass seed. I know we're going to get a lot of calls, so I'm going to try to get that out. It's some grant through the Department of Agriculture. I really don't know much more.
It's a soil conservation thing. We have a poster up here on the bulletin board. It's basically soil conservation provisions. By putting in the grasses, it's going to be able to protect and renutrinize or put nutrients back into the soil, and that's the intent.
As long as it rains.
As long as it rains, yeah. That's
always good to drop grass seed when it doesn't rain.
Right. Yeah.
So I'll keep the board as when I know, if I know, I'll let the board know. Paving is supposedly finally going to start on the 15th, and it's going to commence that whole week. So hopefully from stem to stern, we'll be finally paved. The hiring of part-time reserve at dispatchers is coming to a culmination. We're currently doing the backgrounds on all six, and I'm hoping within the next month they'll be hired. You'll appoint them, and we'll be on our merry way of fixing things. No, it's problematic because they all work full time. So they're doing a lot of work, but like, I would like to think by Halloween. Again, it depends on how much they could dedicate from their own jobs. They were supposed to be in the other night, and they got held over with their own full time jobs. So I'm hoping as quick as can, because as soon as they're done, we're going to segue to obviously the other ones. About a month ago, I'm sure the board already knows, I met with the school board and the superintendent, more of a how do you do, so they can at least put a face with the name. We did talk briefly, obviously, about the school resource officer. Overall, I think it was met with a very positive reaction, but we're going to obviously have a follow-up meeting, I'm hoping probably next month. But we are on our way of obviously talking with the school board as the board had wished. One last thing, there was a problem. It seems like there's a lot of power outages in town, and most recently it was last week. I'm going to put out a press release on behalf of myself, the fire chief, and the emergency management director. I'm going to have to ask the public not to call dispatch center and ask us when the power is going to be turned on. We know no more.
It's on their website.
That's it. And there was a... I guess a food bar the other day, there were a lot of people calling us, hey, can you get the power turned on? When is the power coming on? I wish I had that kind of power as the police chief that I could make that happen. Unfortunately, I don't yet. I'm working on it. But there was a fire call that was misdirected to someplace else because it was the perfect storm of a lot of people calling the one dispatcher all at the same time. Fire police had their calls, and people standing at the window. A call was missed, and it could have been a catastrophic event, and I don't want that to happen. We just don't know any more than you three know when the power is going to be turned on. And I just ask people to obviously call EverSource, because they're going to want to know. Yes.
National Grid.
Excuse me. Well, thank you.
Actually, go on their website.
Yeah, the website is the perfect place, and they want to hear from their customers so they can give the exact address.
The other thing is the more
people,
hits you might say that National Grid gets in a particular neighborhood, the more they focus on that.
Right.
So it actually is to your advantage to follow the National Grid, because if a certain neighborhood has 50 calls and another neighborhood few blocks away only has two, they go to the one with 50 first.
Correct. So the three of us are going to put out a press release hopefully within the next week or so, but I just want to kind of keep the board apprised of that one particular issue. Because if it's not, from the rainstorm, it's going to be from a blizzard.
I would suggest that in that press release, make sure that it might be interpreted that the police don't want to have anything to do with the residents or the fire, don't have anything to do with the residents when the power goes out now. So in that press release, you have to make sure that it's said that we have the cooling room that we have, and
yep,
the charging room for your cell phones, that we have generators that people need. And, a lot of people are on wells, and it's happened before, that they don't have any water for their, well, they don't have any power, their wells don't work.
Yep.
They don't have any power
Well, kind of almost like what Dave said, kind of encourage them to make more phone calls to the so-called source to kind of alleviate that. But you're absolutely right, Glenn, is to, yeah, it's not that we don't want the phone calls. We just can't have all those phone calls dumped at once with one person working in there. It just becomes problematic. And if a life-saving event happens, we need to be there first and trying to find the power switch. But if I do get that extra power to turn on some power, I will certainly let the board know that. So that's all I have. Thank you. I appreciate the time.
I just want to recognize everybody in the audience. I know you came in. I heard what we discussed, and we had said last time this is going to be an iteration of several different meetings. So just wanted to ask if anybody had any comments or questions before we move on to the next item.
I have a comment, yes.
Jim Warden, Reno Drive. I would just like to thank the board. I think you guys did a fine job in resolving a particularly difficult issue, especially from the starting point where we had four rooms that you could rent.
Can I ask you, so for the last 3 to 4 weeks, is cars gone except for a few?
I don't have the pleasure of living down there yet. I haven't built my house yet. But as far as the enforcement goes, everything I've heard, police, fire, building, and health, I certainly, and with neighbor complaints, I have no doubt that this is going to be well covered and it'll be controlled to the best it can be. And you mentioned the change in bylaws come October. I assume you guys are drafting that.
Mike's actually voting.
Yeah, that will be interesting. And I do hope, I think, for the better of the town, not only my neighborhood, is that that's limited to two rooms and four people, but that might be a dream. Who knows? But again, thank you very much.
I know you're, go ahead.
Yeah. Just one new point.
Can I ask you a question first?
Yeah, sure.
Just because you do live on Florida Drive, have there been less people staying overnight?
Yes, they have been less. Other than on one occasion, there were 13 cars there, which that was during their temporary permit that you designated to be less than that. But other than that, it's been less. I just have two quick points. One is, in thinking of fines, they should probably be relative to what they charge, because they charge 500 and something and 700 and something for a room for a night. Yes. Go on the website, sure.
Mike, are we limited by statute?
Yes.
The Mass General Laws.
They limit that, okay.
And we have the highest limit?
Yes.
The other thing is...
But every day is a separate fine.
Oh, okay. The other thing is, I'm not too popular, obviously, and neither are some of the other people on the street for complaining.
We'll work together for an equitable solution.
The town has been working with us fine. Taunting doesn't help the situation, and I'm thick enough skinned, but when I'm out in the driveway, or Marianne is out in the driveway, and someone goes by and they either stop, sit and look, black SUV, who I think is one of the renters, I don't know for sure, and then a silver car, who's a young adult, he speeds up, I mean, lays on the accelerator going by. That's fine, but it's just like saying... I don't feel threatened. It's just that now, I am a little, my senses are heightened a little bit because of you have these people who are not too friendly to us. So that's the only other new points. Everything else has been.
Well, if we had power over that, we'd cure a lot of things wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I wish I did.
Yeah.
I have a lot of power, but that's not one. I really wish we did. I mean, that's...
Yeah.
Thank you.
No, thank you. Appreciate it.
Andy Kafalis, also on Wondery No Drive. And I'm, first of all, I'm one of the ones that that maybe the chief was mentioning. But I actually did call because somebody speeding by when my wife was there with a dog and really flew by. And I called, but I did call the dispatcher. And the dispatcher said that they would send a car, but they suggested they were going to put me on the chief's line and that I should leave. And that was one of those nights, but I had called the dispatcher initially. And the other thing is that the cars are a little bit better. I don't know what the houseboat is that's behind there. Maybe you fellas know.
The I think it's a Chinese job.
Probably, yeah, but the two-deck
houseboat. I was in Bangkok, and I think that was the same one I slept in Bangkok.
Maybe. But I don't know if that has something to do with making up for the rooms that we cut down or what because of the thing that's been going on. But anyway, that's my only comment. Thank you very much.
You can't speculate, but I think all the boards and towns have done what their due diligence on that. And on that. So it is what it is.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. All right. Thank you. Thanks, Carmen.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks a lot.
Liz is chair.
I know, but
Liz is running a tight ship, too.
Yeah, what's the line? I keep trying to get away, but they keep pulling me back. That's a good thing.
Finally got somebody who's organized.
How could we
running the boat.
You if you won't go?
somebody should write a song named that.
There
is a song.
No, I'm helping chairing this year, just administratively, but we've kept Rick as the brains of the operation. So, my name's Liz Callahan, and along with Rick Parker, we have two other members on the Energy Advisory Committee, Tom McCrane and Howard Bleichfeld. And we just wanted to come here tonight to go through the list of what we've identified as priorities for the next year. We just want to make you aware of what we're working on, get your feedback on those items. There are a couple questions we have for you regarding that. So shouldn't take too long, but you know it's a small committee, and we really wanted to maximize our time and our efforts and put them towards projects that would bring the most in terms of energy efficiency. So our committee's met a couple times recently, and we identified three projects that we'd like to explore. They may not all pan out, but we at least want to take some of the initial steps in terms of looking into whether they'd be feasible. Those include a community shared solar project, some potential for additional solar up at the Page School, and the third item is reaching out to the school building committee that's been formed for the high school in terms of offering our support on energy efficiency measures. And then the last item there is just to bring you up to speed in terms of the tracking we're doing under the Green Communities Program. We have to report to them. So,
can you explain that last one a little bit? What's involved in that?
So we're a green community, as you know, and when we became a green community, we had to meet certain criteria. And then going forward, you have to report to them annually in terms of your success in incorporating energy efficiency measures and in reducing the town's environmental footprint. And there are some items that we signed on to as part of becoming a green community that we need to update them on. An example of that is fuel-efficient vehicle policy. We put that into place. And so as we go forward and we purchase new vehicles, we report back to them annually the change in the makeup of our vehicle fleet, and we demonstrate that we're meeting that fuel-efficient vehicle policy. There are a couple other tracking measures that
So, and if you don't mind my speaking, so in general terms, as when we were designated a green community, part of what we had agreed to do was to target a 20% energy reduction energy use reduction by the municipality, not by the residents of town, but by the municipality.
Okay.
And it was supposed to be over 5 years. The target is 20% over 5 years. Quite frankly, we were we weren't that bad to begin with. So 20% for us was going to be a hard nut to crack. We didn't report last year because we didn't get, I had said I'd pull all the stuff together, and quite honestly, it took a lot more time than anticipated. I don't know exactly what we have seen for reduction. Certainly we've seen some reduction in our energy usage and, you know, the municipality's energy usage, but the goal is this 20% number. So we have to look at energy use by all town facilities, including vehicles, buildings, everything in town.
So 20% of everything.
20% of everything in the that belongs to the municipality. Right.
So exactly. If we do 5% in oil heat versus 30% in electricity,
it's all additive. So, you know, so everywhere, you know, for instance, you know, we received a grant of $140,000, roughly, that was used for lighting in this building, in the public safety building, in the library, and that put in all this LED lighting, and, you know, that will significantly reduce the energy usage for lighting within those buildings. And so that will go towards our 20% reduction.
What are the main drivers?
Vehicle fuel usage probably isn't. I don't know. The data's there. I haven't studied it to tell you, but I bet it's not much more than 10%. Yeah. It's mostly heat, probably.
Oil.
Both oil and natural gas. So, page was part of our baseline. We're getting deeper into this than I had expected to. I know you're tight on time. That's right. I'm just answering the question. Exactly. I mean, we could go as deep as you want, but it could take much more time than you want. So.
But the PAGE project counts toward it. Right?
That's right. Yeah. Additional solar PV put in at PAGE, it would not actually count towards reducing our baseline because it's still energy used. But there's some form of credit they make, and I don't recall how it works exactly if we start replacing electricity that came through fossil fuels with renewables. But
so we're
but
on a 5-year schedule that we're supposed to be able to reduce our, or we have to reduce our energy by 20%, still be eligible for the grant? And if that's the case, what year are we in on that 5-year?
Well, quite honestly, we're probably at year 4 or 5 right now. But don't worry about that. That's not that No, that's
the,
I mean, you know, we'll the point is for us to stay engaged with the Green Communities Program,
mm-hmm.
and that's part of what that requires is the annual reporting, which is where this all started. And just so you understand that there's an annual reporting requirement, and that we will be reaching out to certain town departments asking for energy usage data. And so far, everybody's always been very cooperative, but just so you understand that there is a certain amount of dialogue that goes on.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
So we, Rick and I, think we'll be pulling that information together September. We have a deadline, an internal deadline for getting it together by the end of the year. And we've already talked to the Green Communities Program, so they know we're doing this two-year report. And we also wanted to thank Mike McCarron because he had gone to Merrimack Valley Planning Council and submitted a grant application on our behalf to get some assistance in the future going forward in pulling together this information. So you hopefully we'll get that grant money as well, and that will help us in the future. So that really is just kind of a maintenance item that we as the Energy Committee are committed to doing, is maintaining our eligibility for the Green Communities. In terms of the project, the Community Shared Solar Project, this is a kind of a natural follow-on to the solar flare project that we had it going on in the town last year. For those people that aren't putting solar on their own residences, for whatever reason, they may not have the right situation or solar resource at their house, or they may be renting it or not really interested in having solar at their residence. There is a program of community shared solar where either a public entity or a private landowner can develop a solar field, and shareholders can purchase or lease or buy into that that solar project. Excuse me?
Purchase a share.
They can purchase
a
share,
sort of
effectively.
Sort of akin to purchasing a share. Yeah. Essentially, you build a larger system, and it's allocated over a number of households, and then the power is net metered and applied to their usage. Yeah.
And there is someone in West Newbury who has an interest in developing a community solar project. Rick's looked at the site and has scoped it out so far. I don't know if you want to describe that.
Yeah, he wouldn't actually be developing it. Somebody who's expressed interest in using his land. He lives on Kent's Way, Kent's Court, which is off of Crane Neck Street, and the land backs up onto the water department right-of-way, or the water department land that runs from Main Street up to the top of Brake Hill. So that would potentially be a corridor to run power line down to the three-phase power lines on Main Street. I did have a very unofficial conversation with Mike Goutet, who thought that was an interesting concept and might actually, in the end, be beneficial to the water department because at some point in time they'd like to have power up on top of the hill. So conceivably it would all fit together and benefit both community shared solar as well as the water department. So there's a lot of background work to be done, but we kind of wanted to present this to you, seeing as ultimately, this committee exists because you've created it. We want to make sure that you guys understand what we're thinking about and see if there are any specific questions or concerns or...
Can something come together before town meeting? Do you have a report to people?
No, there's too much
that'd
to do before
too
that.
Soon,
yeah.
I think. Spring, possibly, yeah.
Possibly.
I think what we wanted to hear from you is if it's okay if we pursue this in terms of just looking into it, whether it would be feasible.
Yeah, I mean, the town, the municipality will not have skin in the game. It is not a financial commitment on the part of the municipality, and we have to figure out just how does this all fit together. The DOER, Mass Department of Energy Resources, is trying to promote community shared solar, so undoubtedly we're going to be leaning on them for some at least structural support in how to put it together.
It will eventually need a zoning overlay,
right?
Though,
right.
So
that's right. Just as the site at Page School required, and any additional solar up at Page School would require a zoning overlay district to create a zone by right. The same thing would have to be done here. So that would require working with the planning board as well.
Sounds good.
Okay.
The And Rick just mentioned the Page School. We also wanted to look into, beyond the footprint of the PV that's up there now, whether there was some potential for additional solar there, with maybe the Page School being the off-taker of the power, whether that would be feasible. We know that we would have to be talking to the school district if we wanted to pursue something like that, because with the school district paying or for the operational costs of the Page School, if this is something they're interested in, that would probably be one of the first conversations we would need to have. So before we looked into that, this is another idea that we wanted to run by you to get your sense of whether you would like us to pursue that and you'd be okay with that.
They don't have any control of that land.
We're talking about the Page School. What we lease, we lease the school district, the Page School.
Right.
And land that goes with it, just not the school.
No, not enough to put a solar field anywhere.
Okay.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure how much land was down back.
And it basically is that the DPW building and the rec building are both not leased to the school district. So really they just have what is the playground and the parking areas.
Yeah, so you know,
I just put out one other thing too, is that the advantage of that is that we do pay 8.25% of the energy costs for the Page School because of the children's gas. Because it's all 1 meter. Mm-hmm. So under our lease agreement, 8.25% of the energy costs are actually borne by the town.
Yeah, the town and the school district would have to negotiate how the power was allocated and how, you know, what the exact financial exchange was. And you know, I don't know.
Is there enough land up there to even be able to put another substantial field up there that would even
there most likely is. I'd say almost certainly, but I wouldn't say absolutely certainly. And it might not even be, the best piece might not even be immediately adjacent to where the existing field. And that's why, you know, it's, again, this is a project that's going to require a fair amount of thought and some effort. And, you know, but we wanted to run it by, before we didn't want to spin our wheels for no reason. So we wanted to run this by you and, excuse me?
Can you think about that one?
Sure.
Yeah, it seems complicated because figuring out the payment to the school district and then them paying us back or what we're contributing, it sounds complicated.
No. Rick, I would think that the Page School one, that would be behind the meter, wouldn't it?
Yes, that would be behind that. That's what we, but you know, we really need to talk with somebody who has a better handle on how to get the best financial gain. I mean, the goal is, besides, you know, reducing our carbon footprint, is to get a financial gain, and philosophically, it makes the most sense to put it behind the meter. But if you recall. You know, in the early discussions with the current field, that in the end it made sense not to be behind the meter, mm-hmm. or, you know, to create a new service, basically. So, you know, I don't know the best way to get the most financial gain out of it.
I said, if you think about that, I was going to ask Mike.
Yeah.
That's their thought.
Sure. I think that's fine. That's appropriate. I mean, I don't want to speak out of turn here.
Nope.
You're the chairperson.
Nope.
far be it for me to say, no, you can't think about that. But when... when... Glenn...
Oh, boy.
When would be a good time to check back in on that?
September.
September?
Our second meeting in September.
Okay.
And then we would ask Mike and Mike to kind of look at it for us and advise us. That sound good?
That sounds good. Yeah, I mean, okay. Nothing's going to happen real fast anyway. So it's, you know, it's, and you know, and even at, and even after, you know, you've had a chance to think about it, then we need to talk with the school district and, you know, everybody needs
maybe
to sort of be on the same page.
And we
yeah.
Can bring it, the best plan would be bring it to the spring town meeting. That would be the best plan.
Can I ask a sort of relevant question? I remember initially when the first field was developed, there was pushback from people that checking everybody's inbox. Has anyone gotten any complaints about the visual effect of the solar field? I just wondered if anyone had, because that was never, I always discounted it, but a lot of people were, just had a problem with the way it was going to look. Oh, it's going to ruin 113, so I just wondered if anyone had ever, has anyone had any complaints?
I have not.
I've had one.
No.
And that wouldn't even be considered a legitimate complaint.
I've heard.
I think just from a neighbor or something from way up the street and says you can see it now. I don't believe you can see it. I don't think it was legitimate. But I would say no.
Yeah.
And you're right, we just need to do it. We're ruining the beautiful roadways and stuff, and what's a better beautiful thing to look at? The solar, saving energy and saving trees and all that.
And anything new that's built there would also be farther removed
less
from
visible.
The road and perhaps completely obscured by what's already there. Yeah.
I was just curious whether after all that complaining beforehand whether people actually did complain.
So on your third item, and I would applaud you and encourage you to talk to the school building committee. I mean, I think that's a great idea, the more input they can have and learn about the energy efficiency. I mean, that's everybody's benefit.
I'm the representative on the school building committee for the Board of Selectmen.
Oh.
We haven't even had a meeting yet. It hasn't even been approved by the school building authority in Boston yet. You have to send your stuff in. So when that happens, when the committee is formed in a more of a formal thing, and then a chairperson is picked, I'll reach out to Chris and tell you who the chairperson is, so you could ask to be on the agenda to talk about this.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what we're looking for. We want to be helpful, but we also want to have your support so they're not saying, well, what's this group here?
Yeah. And you're not going to
No. I mean, at this point in time, I mean, you don't just look at building costs; you look at operational costs as well, and longevity, and you know, you integrate energy efficiency in early on, then you probably extend the life of the building and reduce its operating costs.
I think we covered everything, but I have a question.
Uh-oh.
It's just a simple one. I was just curious.
Yeah.
How many participants did we get with that solar flare? I'm just curious.
I think, if I remember right, in the end, I think it was 45 systems on through that program. I might be off by one or two. No, it went quite well. We didn't hit the, you know, we were hoping for, if we'd hit 400 kilowatts of new installed capacity, then the town was going to be given a 5 kilowatt system to be installed somewhere at the town's discretion. We got to like 382 kilowatts or something.
Wow.
We just
missed it.
Yeah.
Is it still going?
No, it was, you know, it ended at the end of the year. So, you know, that's the way it goes. It was 2 to 3 systems. 2 to 3 systems more. Because the average size was about 8.3 kilowatts. So it's like 3 systems more would have pushed us well over. So, you know, that's the way it goes. All in all, it was pretty successful, and it's interesting for whatever it's worth that, you know, since then, I mean, you know, simultaneous with that program, there were other systems being built, you know, because, of course, Solar City had that really aggressive program in town, and other businesses have as well. So there now are something like between 110 and 120 systems in town. So it works out to be somewhere between 8% and 9% of the residential structures in town have solar now. You know, it's pretty amazing. I think that thanks to the whole thing worked, and I think it just that helped to motivate people, other people to who didn't use that program, but they put it in anyway. So yeah. So that was the goal.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks.
Half my bedtime. not quite. Delivered meal.
Town, none.
Yeah. So I'd ask them for that. I think the primary driver of the discussion is what are the potential uses for the building? I know, we've talked, and I know you've said that the building committee and the historical committee have talked about a museum, historical, right? I mean, you tell me, but I guess what we want to do is
well, a couple of things that, if memory serves me, there were a couple of things that were supposed to be done in the stabilization that weren't done. There was some work to be done on the slate roof, which has not been done. They were supposed to, and it's a small, minor thing, they were supposed to replace the sump pump down cellar. That hasn't been done. That was part of the stabilization. Those two things maybe need to be looked at. I think we need to get together again with the committee, figure out where we go now, because the brickwork needs to be done, because there's a lot of pointing up and stuff that needs to be done. And I'd like to see all that stuff done by professionals that can match 1900 mortar, or make the 2000 grade mortar match the 1900 mortar, so it doesn't look like you've got gray mortar here and bright white over here, so it looks, but
yes. $1,000 an hour.
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Well, it is what it is when it's done, but one of the driving forces was, hey, we wanted to keep the business, the building as a historical building.
Yes.
Then we're not sure what we want to do with it, but we understand it's going to cost a lot of money to do. So let's spend some money and stabilize the building, and then we can start off with a program and or whatever.
Which we did.
So did we
I think we did. I mean, there was a couple of things that should, a couple of things that should have been done, and one of the things was, like I said, some work on the slate roof.
Yeah, we had this conversation before.
But it wasn't done.
They had results saying that, yeah, everything was done that it needed to be done.
But, yeah.
Is the tower sealed up?
Yes.
Yeah, oh,
yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Okay, tower sealed up, is the built the walls
they
out falling out?
They put those supports on the
yes.
second floor?
Yes,
You know what? I'll check with Gary, too, and I can see you don't have to come back when you talk, and I'll make sure that I'll report back the next day. So then, was to stabilize the building. Then, the next thing was to get it on the historic thing, and that's when I went into Boston. We had that grant that they wrote up, and then it got accepted, then it goes into the national parks for them to have a full acceptance. And that opens up grant money.
I'm still waiting to hear from the federal.
I was told by the guy that we don't have to hear from him.
Oh.
That as soon as the state does it, the grant stuff can start happening.
All right, then we need to start looking at
the historical commissioner that, or that the Crop Post Committee, to start looking into grants to restore the building back to its regular thing, the building.
For right now, for what we envision the building being used for, a tight tank will serve the purpose that we need. In conversation.
So where would that be, Bob?
Probably out where the whatever we have for leach field or for holding tank is now is off to the Newburyport side of the building. I have no idea. It's in the side of the building.
Yeah, like that back side, right over there.
Yeah. I don't know what's out there. I really don't. And I don't think anybody else does.
I don't think we need to do anything about it now. I think we just need to take whatever people want to give to us, and that tight tank can be put in under any circumstances.
Well, I think we want to dig up the ground before they're offering to landscape everything, put a parking lot in. We want to put it in before that's done. But that's not for a couple of years.
Yeah, that's probably another year before he's ready to do that. Right, yeah.
Why don't you say yes to everybody and then we'll see what happens?
I mean, I think it would be, it really may be short-sighted to turn the landowner down that was willing to donate the land.
I'd take that.
Yeah, yeah, but just take that.
There's so many questions about what we want to do, just take it.
Yeah.
It's just
perfect. Yeah, there is the rest
of it. We don't need it today.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
there's still some issues with the building inspector and stuff about what we can do and cannot do with the second floor of that building.
Because of what? ADA?
Egress. ADA compliance. He's told us we cannot put the fire escape back on that building. So that leaves us with a second floor with no second form of egress.
And what was his reasoning?
It didn't really, state law or something. There's got
to
be a way to do it.
Was that fire escape the original fire escape?
I honestly don't know.
Do you remember back then? So there had to have been a second egress, right?
Well, that was it when they tore it. But
well, I know that.
I honestly don't know. I would think. I almost want to think so. But that's. I'm not 100% sure. It's a possibility. You're also got working with historic buildings and stuff like that. There may be some leeway to do
that's
certain
right.
things.
Building,
right. You might be might be bring it back to its original. Right. Right. I mean, it needs to be further research just to see. But I,
would it have to be sprinkling?
I'm not sure. Right. I wouldn't think so. I'm not sure either. It may be. I don't.
The most out of this building, most out of this meeting would be, hey,
that part of it is sealed.
Yeah, that part is sealed. Yeah. It's just dry in there.
And then, when can you guys, without rushing you guys, legitimately come back to us and say, okay, listen, we contacted this agency, that agency, we have grants going in, this is how we foresee this building as being bringing it back to, Luster as being, quote unquote, a museum or whatever. We're looking for you guys, the historic and this car post committee,
okay,
to tell us what to do. You know what I mean? So we can say,
right.
How about not necessarily paying for a formal mail survey or something, but at the town meeting, have a little form that people could leave off, so that we get some people completely thinking outside the box of ideas that we haven't even thought of. What would people like to do with it?
A non-binding thing, maybe even
ideas.
On our website.
On our new website. On our new website, too. Yeah.
You can do a Survey Monkey. They're basically free, and they can just do it on the internet. Get feedback.
It would be nice to have some input from the town of what they'd like to see happen, not just us. Coming up with
that. We would like to hear what you have to say, then we'll figure out the timeline. So if you guys can do that, maybe come back to us in a month or a month and a half.
Right.
Or something.
Yeah. Talk to Gary and see if we can get a meeting going. And
yeah, I would include Gary.
Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely.
Yeah, and Glenn.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Yep. Not a problem.
Okay. Just going back to the top of the agenda to circle back. Appointments. The only appointments are a couple of people for the Bill Pond Committee. One is a full-year full member, one is an associate member. They're 3-year terms, but there's also supposed to be 7 members, so there's already enough people for the current 3-year appointment. So this one is a
small dollar amounts, like, you know, we know the fire suppression is with the air tanks is there. There's a small one for communications. But then we have to decide, are we going to open it up and allow people to ask for additional things?
No.
You know, how do you want to handle it? How do you want to handle it?
This is a cleanup. Does anybody have the criteria that we put up?
Yeah, but this was the stuff that was unforeseen.
Right, or they can't wait from a time sensitivity. Like, I think a bylaw for a B&B maybe should be talked about now, not this spring.
Correct.
So, okay, so then let's have the finance committee, finance director, town council be on the 19th of September.
I mean, this is tight. We have to start moving on this.
Well, that's why I'm bringing it up.
Yeah.
You okay with that, Chief?
It doesn't seem like a lot of time for them.
Well, and then if it's the 19th, well, I don't know that there's going to be that many items. So when should we have all special article requests due to Chris to give the finance committee time? I mean, I would say no later than the 9th.
9th of September.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, everybody's got it in the back of their head. It's just
that. That means they can only have one meeting.
Well, that's a final due date. I mean, hopefully people wouldn't wait till the due date to send it in.
That's all they should need. I think everything is, you know, this is things
they started,
that didn't
one second. The FinCom has put out some new rules and regulations on how they want articles at town meeting to be, how they want to be
to consider,
reviewed.
Right.
So,
I heard that.
Yeah, I heard. So, it's a little bit more comprehensive than before, and I don't even think comprehensive, but, you know, they're really going by the FinCom bylaw. I can see that some department heads could come with not enough information, and they could be sent back to another meeting.
Well, then they better not wait until September 9th to get their articles.
Okay. I'm just saying.
I think the bigger criteria is when I send out an email to let people know that this is the date and if you want any items to be considered, you know.
When's Labor Day? The 5th?
Yes.
Today's the 8th?
Yes. That's enough of
that. Joe, also, Labor Day is the 5th, and
yeah. So
the next day, Tuesday, are you traveling or? Can we do the 6th?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a meeting that day?
Yeah.
Okay. So we haven't done. If he sends out an email tomorrow and says that this is her criteria and all our articles need to be at the close of business September 6th.
Well, if you want to give the Finance Committee an extra week to.
Yeah, I want to give them.
Then make it September 2nd then. Friday.
Unforeseen things that were rejected in a previous town meeting?
Well, no. Unforeseen that was rejected, those are two different things.
No, this is it, exactly. Unforeseen,
yeah.
You know, expenditures.
This is just housekeeping, more or less, that we owe to, or something unforeseen, right? Yeah, nothing that was rejected at a previous one.
Right, it doesn't mean you can't change it. I mean, we're still going by the old way. You know, it's hard to run a town with one meeting a year. So to give
that's
people.
That's why we have the October one, and that's why we're doing it. But I think Casey Swallow mentioned when she was sitting here that our fall town meeting started to look like a spring town meeting with so many capital outlays and so forth and so on. And I think we all agreed with that. So we said this is just more housekeeping.
Right, that's why.
Stuff, no, no cruisers, no dump trucks.
I'm just
no,
suggesting
basically
it. Just because one person.
Last year is what I'd like to say again.
Yeah, I think we all agree. But
yes.
I mean,
it worked better last year.
I'm pressing it because he needs. If we're doing the second, it's the
criteria am I going by? Just unforeseen? Because, you know, I know what people think, but having two meetings a year is still minimal, and I you know.
Yeah, but it worked, my point being is that I wish we had what we said last year. It all worked fine, and I didn't even hear one complaint, actually. I really didn't.
So, I mean, I'm just, that's just my suggestion, is that you open it to certain things to consider. If you don't, then unless anybody has any unforeseen expenditures that revolve around, you know,
well,
public safety and welfare.
I mean, like the fire apparatus is not unforeseen, but I would encourage him to,
That could be time sensitive.
Or time sensitive. Unforeseen, time sensitive. If a plow breaks in half, or realize it broke in half, and we need to replace it, that's unforeseen. And, you know, so of course we're going to do it, we're going into a snow season.
Right.
If that was the case, that would be something that we would put on in the spring. I think we'll beat it up. I think Joe's right. Let him do it, and then we'll decide.
But, I mean, if 30 articles come in, that's not going to go, but there's 50 of them.
The most important thing is getting the word out that
yes,
the deadline. Now, what game do you want to play? Is it one of these deadline, or a phone call goes to Chris and there's a placeholder from the water department?
92.
A placeholder from the water department or the rec department and saying, you know, we just don't have our material ready, but could you put a placeholder in?
Well,
I agree. We just have, but we have to.
I would never tell anybody that they could have it there.
I never said you did.
Okay.
I never said that.
Yeah.
But you'll get a phone call if you do everything single year that we don't have, and we end up with a placeholder. So I just want to make sure that people understand that's a hard date, not a soft date.
Yeah.
Good. Thanks for doing that.
Yeah. Okay. Selectmen's objectives. We've had this on a couple times. Are we good with this? We kind of keep kicking the can down the road. I think we're all in general agreement. Last time we were, I thought we were, but do you have other things to add?
I just wondered, looking back on what we had thought about last year versus what we accomplished, I don't want this, it's not going away, but I just don't want us to forget about it. I still think we should, we've always tried to have a some way of determining, say, when land that might become available to the town, and we want to buy it, not buy it, versus what land that we already have. We still haven't really formalized all the information that has been gathered over the years about the town-owned land and, you know.
So are you talking about the open space priority parcels, or are you talking about the land we already have?
Combining the two. Like, there are land that we have now that maybe we're underutilizing, maybe we don't need, versus when open spaces, land that they are ultimately desirous of, maybe there's a trade-off. There's those kind of things. I don't think we don't have a big plan.
We've talked about this forever.
I know.
And I think we all agree with you. So how do we get from point A to point B? How do we get there? Compile all the information that we possibly have. I thought we got that into John Sarkis.
We did, but it's sort of just sitting there. I don't think we really, if someone mentioned a particular piece of land, well, what is its best usage?
Okay, so what about having a working session this fall on a non-selecting night? And invite everybody in. Is the selectmen are considering, we're evaluating all the land. If we want to keep it or sell it, you'll get everybody here.
That would, yeah.
affordable housing, recreation, anything like that. The selectmen, we're going to have a working group to make some decisions. Let it come out of the woodwork. Right?
That's true.
What, want to do it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Working on an off select and then sometime in the fall, let's do it.
Well, I mean, so we'll add that to the list. I don't know why you stand left off, but the capital improvements is part of the finance.
Okay.
We said that last time.
Yeah, it needs to be.
Yeah, it'll be, we're talking about it next week. I move to approve this draft as the selectmen goals for 2017 with the addition of the selectmen priorities of adding a working group to, working meeting to review talent.
Can I second that for discussion?
Yeah.
Can we have an update on, can we have like an update in a meeting about this and what we've achieved and what we haven't achieved in January?
For this?
Yeah.
Sure.
Because you just seem to do it and then we can talk about that next year. Maybe, if, like what Archie said, maybe it might help if we kind of review what we've done and what we haven't done. And
well, I'm just guessing that these four selectmen priorities and now five, that we're going to be highly focused on those four.
Yes.
That'd be shocking if we weren't.
I would agree.
Okay. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Minutes.
Make a motion to accept the minutes as amendments of July 25th, 2016.
Second, but I also have some amendments that I'd like to offer. Chris, if that's okay with you.
I will take that friendly amendment and give those to Chris.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Payroll and invoice warrants.
Make a motion to approve the invoice warrants.
Are there any stickies on the end? Second, are there any stickies?
There were stickies. Yeah, there's a few. On the invoice warrants, there was
the invoice on the right? Those are that's payroll, right?
No, these are those are payroll. They,
oh.
The invoices, there were three related to Parks and Rec on the invoices that need, I think, need signatures.
Oh.
Can we have some yellow? Somebody's, but I don't know who wrote. I wrote one or two of them, but there was another one.
Well, do they have signatures?
It's unclear. It's not signed by department head or board. It's signed by the name of the line. So I would amend my motion that we approve those to make sure that the proper signature is put in.
Or, so we're approving the invoice warrants with the proper signatures by Tuesday or pulling them from the check line?
Correct.
Okay. Are we comfortable with that?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
I move to approve the payroll warrants.
Second.
Stickies.
There is one. Is this Joe writing or is this
signatures?
Yeah. It's.
I think I did write something. So
yeah. Okay. There's one.
There's a signature on now?
No. It's this. It's this one. Did you write that? What's the name?
Oh, no supervisor signature.
Mm-hmm.
What's the law that has to be an employee or a supervisor signature?
Yep.
There has to be someone who signs it attesting to that it's a true and accurate one. So it's supposed to be a supervised one. The technically an employee doesn't have to sign. We do it because it's a check. But it's gotta be the supervisor.
Okay. So it's Parks and Recs again. I mean, we had a different issue with Parks and Recs last time on the amount, but this is.
It's gotta be, state law says that somebody's gonna attest to that, that's an accurate.
Well, are we attesting to it by signing the overall warrant?
No, this is independent of that.
So how do you handle it? How do you pay it then? Because you have to pay payroll.
Well,
last time I had them come in and sign it before.
Yeah, that's how you do it.
Oh, yeah, they came in and I sent an email to everybody.
Yeah, you just basically get the signature.
Yeah.
You can approve it conditioned upon getting
proper signature.
Proper signature.
You sent an email that they came in?
Yes. Yeah, they came in and everything was signed and filled out.
Wow.
Signing the municipal modernization bill, there are a lot of articles in there that will, you know, will affect the town. Mike is already, you know, planning to set up, you know, department heads, what effect it could happen. So you might want to, maybe not take them all at once, but to start looking at them and have them some discussion, because some of them will have your input. Things like changes to exemptions for, you know,
Can you guys advise us with a master list?
Then yeah, we gotta get plugged into that.
If you could, in Cliff Stokes version, just don't say you can go to massgeneral.gov.
Don't you like? I always thought you wanted to go there.
No, not really. If you could, in the next whatever month, and then we can start.
He hasn't signed it yet.
It's tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but there's a lot of impact. So you guys might know. I don't think you want to put them all on one agenda, but you might want to start putting them on.
Yeah. Okay, good. Thank you. Do we need to start to discuss the common cash renewal proposal, or is that something that you would like to have?
We've already met with them once. Good. So
we got the...
They were going to come back, and Mike has a proposal they came back with, him and I have to go over it, and then have a meeting with her. It's pretty boilerplate.
Good.
We already have a meeting with them. Add a meeting.
look at, like, the last 10 years of what that number is and what the reserve ratio is during that same time, so we can see, you know, kind of which way it's going. I think it's going up, but I think what's his name, the auditor did something like that in the last audit, similar to that. So that's one thought. On the high school building project, we, you know, I created that, I'll call it a theoretical chart, because we didn't have any numbers. And we still don't have any numbers, but I think we have a much better idea that we could put some much better numbers in there, and we could probably carry it out a few more years if we're going to be short on any funding when we actually have to start making payments, because maybe it's going to happen sooner. You know, how much is that, and is that something we could potentially supplement with free cash? So those are kind of two thoughts that I had to get some actual information to help facilitate that discussion. Any thoughts?
I guess my first thought is there is a policy out there that talks a lot about this, an older policy that's been updated, but it has to be updated to reflect the different stabilizations when you're talking about undesignated free cash. In other words, we don't have a general stabilization. We have a capital project stabilization, we have a school stabilization, and we have
pension reserve.
A pension stabilization.
So unassigned fund balance accounts at all?
Right. No. Unassigned fund balance is money that we can put towards these things.
Oh, that's like
free cash. Yeah, so what we really should do is probably even have a general stabilization. So then when we set aside money that's going to bring us down to what our ceiling would be, which would be 5%. So essentially, you never want to go, the policy says you never want to go below 700. So,
of free cash.
So the money we have to spend is between 700 to whatever that number comes in. Mm-hmm. So you could always spend it down just until you get to that 5%. That's what the policy says. But the policy needs to add all the stabilization funds and the criteria that we put in. So someone says, well, we didn't put any money in stabilization. Well, that's not true, because we put 50 in this stabilization, we put 150 here, and instead of withdrawing 150 to pay for the capital that was on the list, we just paid it out of current year
free cash.
So that's the same difference as putting money away. So I think, one, that needs to spell it out, but...
let's put numbers on paper, though, so people can kind of...
Right, and I just think that that's the role, that's their role, I think, is just to, you know, verify that we're going by the policy.
Well, I think we want to have a discussion, too, though, because there's a lot of big money items that are on the table. High school, potentially water, I don't know. Community center, I don't know.
Right, and I think that... Something with the high school, even though we'll probably have capacity under our cap to do it under our levy limit, I don't know necessarily mean that I wouldn't go for the debt exclusion override just to give it support. Because when we do that, even though we're taking the space of debt, it will, you know, our financial flexibility ratio will tighten up a little bit because we're using
You're saying to give yourself some more levy
capacity. I think to give it levy capacity, as long as you can still be disciplined, but also to help support the project that we put it for a vote as well, like the other communities will. In other words, as looking at us as one third of the project, to show our support, to help present it, you know, unilaterally.
Right.
So
and then we could also use...
Do you get Luke's school to do that?
I think to be successful and to help it all pass, especially knowing the track record that education is always supported.
I think there's some people that might say it would look... I'm not saying that some people that would say it would look good if we paid for it and we didn't have to have it.
It's the same difference, though.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? up, so you don't, it's the same difference.
Let's look at numbers, so that's...
Right. I mean, we could, but then if something happens and all of a sudden things get tight, one of our financial flexibilities is having capacity to tax when we're not taxing. Because there's also going to be debt coming, a lot more of the debt that'll
coming
be
off.
Rolling off the books. And most of it, quite frankly, is land. So you really want to see what you're doing with all this land. If it's just going to be open space and people can understand that it's going to be open space, or is it going to be developed and used and kind of strategically set up a different type of, you know, open space?
If we could try to keep the agenda small, so we don't have...
so we can make this big.
Make this big, so we don't feel daunted that, you know, we see 5, 6, 7 items on the thing, people are waiting in the audience, and we can go through. And this is an important discussion.
I agree.
Yeah, and I think that we, at the same time, we sort of want to get at it. If we, even if we don't charge you with the change for a bylaw or a town meeting, we want to get a philosophy of what we want the capital improvements committee to do, to sort of in line with this.
I would agree. Yeah, I have a one page that is a recap of the capital improvements bylaw, so I'll give that to Chris to put the materials to pass out.
So can we... But we may want to align exactly with say what Mike is saying, and we may want to like modernize the whole concept.
Well, that's
awesome.
Yeah. But we need to start with what we currently
have.
Yeah. Yes.
Let's get that working.
Yeah.
And then we'll modernize.
So can you, Mike, put some of the things that we were talking about together by what next was today, the 8th and 17th?
Why don't you shoot him over what you want, and then he'll email him back.
Okay, absolutely.
Okay.
Another thing, Mr. Chairman, is that all you have?
Yeah. Yes.
Is there a date?
I think it's important. I think it's important. Excuse me, both of us.
I just wonder when that date would be.
We're going to do the discussion.
This meeting is it's an agenda item for the 22nd of August.
Okay.
That's the meeting where the Finance Committee capital improvements are coming in.
Can you, Mr. Chairman, can you make sure that Chris and or Mike understands exactly what the article fall town meeting schedule is, written out like you did, and we email that out, or have given to Mike so he can email it out to FinCom and everybody tomorrow, because maybe knows, you know, he did a little change. So I think that's important that we get ahead of that. So if you can make sure that everybody knows that tonight, so it can go out tomorrow with that email.
Yeah. You have this, right?
Yes. So I'll just update it to show the second.
Though. It changed the warrant close date, change 9/2, and scratch off, I said, 4/9/26 on the agenda.
Okay, this is the on my end to look at it.
No, we're just moving the deadline to get them into the